honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior. All beings are born and created by the Kamma. They are formed, shaped, conditioned, elevated, and restricted by their Kamma. These past actions, this past behavior, is a womb of probability from which they re-emerge. All beings are owners of their Kamma, debtors to their Kamma, and they inherit their Kamma. Whatever they do, whether good or bad, the later effects of that will be theirs only. This accumulation of probability follows them like a shadow of the past that never leaves. Therefore does this Kamma come to divide all beings into high and low, beautiful or ugly.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 130, on Kamma, on feelings and emotions, and rebirth locations. And you are indeed welcome. And thank you for your advantageous attention. Thank you.
Friends, very first and primary is establishing these four foundations of awareness. Satipatthana. What, friends, are these four foundations of awareness? They are: one, regarding the body only as a full frame, while always acutely alert and clearly comprehending, thus removing any lust, urge, envy, frustration, and discontent rooted in this world. The intelligent Bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all bodies as an alien frame and filthy foul form, as something bound to emerge, decay, and vanish, neither as something mine, nor belonging to me, nor as what I am, nor as a manifested representation of and myself. He sees the body neither as a lasting nor stable safety, nor as pleasant beauty, nor as pride. Two, noting all feeling only as an annoying reaction. The intelligent Bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all feeling, pleasure, pain, indifference, as a remote, ever recurring response and reactivity, reaction on contact, as something bound to arise, decay, and fade away. Not as mine, felt by me, nor belonging to me, nor as what I am, nor as something felt by this myself, neither as something lasting, stable, or safe, nor as ever pleasure, or bliss. 3. Experience the mind only as a passing set of conditioned moods. The intelligent bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all mind phenomena as a habituated set of bizarre mentalities of a weird nature that appears, dwindles, flutters, and flickers, neither as something that I am, nor as a part of me, nor as making up my ego or myself, neither as something lasting, stable, or sane. He regards mind not as something fascinating, not as a soul. 4. Understanding all phenomena only as momentary mental appearances. The intelligent bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all phenomena as mentally constructed appearances of momentary manifestation, always ending right there where they arised, where they appeared. He regards phenomena whether internal or external, whether past, present or future, not as something mine, nor as belonging to me or any self, not as something lasting, stable or real, not as something existent, enduring, substantial, material, absolute and authentic out there. These 4 are the 4 great frames of reference. The 4 great frames of reference through which all phenomena and experiences should be filtered, compared to, and evaluated out from. This is the fourfold foundation of awareness. This, only this, is the sole way to the purification of beings. Why is it actually so? Because it is an indispensable support for a presence that has to stand near. A presence, a mental presence, that has to stand by all experiences. It has to be made manifest to be of service as a guarding activity. It has to be established as a continuous dominance of clear comprehension. It is essential and absolutely necessary for optimizing any behavior. It is a crucially needed key, imperative for preventing all mistakes. It is a vitally fundamental prerequisite for guidance and self-control. It is the only thing that can overcome relapses of careless neglect. When not aware of what one is doing, mentally, verbally, or bodily, serious mistakes is inevitable. Therefore, is this fourfold foundation of awareness, these 4 great frames of reference, the only way to the purification of all beings. The 4 foundations of awareness. Thank you.
Hello to you friends, this is Dhamma on Air number 130 on Kamma, emotions and feelings, and you are indeed welcome. First I'd like to advertise on Sunday, this Sunday the 9th
of June, there's a smart meditation day and Dhammacharya Buddhist Center here in Denmark, where I give a mini meditation course on the four immeasurable states, and you are indeed welcome there, also to those who live in Denmark. And Hørve lies close to Holbæk, and the address comes here below and is given below in the video description. It is Nørregade 13C, and it's easy to come to there. You take a train to Holbæk and then a small train also to Hørve from there, and it is 5 minutes walk from the station. Then the normal intro. Namo tasso bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha indeed. So we go straight to the questions. It's actually the same person who has asked all these questions about Kamma, but it's so good, so we come around this subject, which is one of the Kammic law is one of the primary constituents of both Buddhism and also Hinduism, a mosquito, and to some extent also one more, a Christian faith and many other faiths. Basically it says that if one do something bad, then something bad comes back from nature. If you do something good, then something good comes back from nature. So one increases one's probabilities for this or that event by one's intentional activity of mind, body, and speech. The first question goes like this. Question 386. We are trawling steadily towards question number 400. Not too bad. Is behavior, personality, and emotions partly heritable, that is in the DNA and chromosomes, and partly karmically determined? Yes, actually it is exactly so. And these two are actually connected. Let's take first the heritable, they are in the DNA. Can one see whether emotions, when it's our tendencies in the DNA? Very little, but still one will see inheritance lines that one kind of like has a tendency to react like one's father and mother. Though it can also be because of the upbringing, but something will be in the genes. Some tendencies and abilities, intelligence, abilities to see, hear, and thereby also one's emotional response. So one's whole genetic setup influences, of course, one's mind in this or that direction, and thereby also the emotions and feelings. However, so do also Kamma. And I would say much stronger than inheritance does. Let's just look at the way of their connection, the Kamma and the inheritance. Yeah, the Kamma, the inheritance you get from your mother and father, and the Kamma determines which mother and father you get. So the Kammic background also determines which social and thereby also which genetic background you're born into and which genes you get from your mother and father. So even though it's genetically determined by genes to some extent, some low probabilities, then you cannot say it's completely free of Kamma, because Kamma in the first place has determined or influenced at least which genes you got. In the transmigration moment, one will in the human case see one's mother and father copulate, and one gets an irresistible lust or desire or tendency to be in the womb of the female. And then immediately after, one is sucked into this womb and then becomes unconscious there, like sleep, for example, or should we say subconscious. And there the fetus then develops and become conscious probably before birth to some extent, and realizes can react at stimuli at least. So even though there's some genetic imprint in one's feelings and emotions, it is not completely determined. It's not completely determined only by that. It's also, of course, determined by circumstances, whether there's light or rain or cold or warmth or so on. So the Buddha say not everything is determined by Kamma. There's also biology, like genes, There's physical circumstances like heat, cold, light, dark, and so on, so forth. But what he said is that Kamma also has a role to play, and this role could be overruling the other factors. Let's look at the Kamma. Yeah, the Kamma, I think, has a much more stronger influence. For example, let's say you get some soft ice. Let's take three factors. We could also say four factors. Let's start with three. There's some soft ice, and your likes or dislikes, whether genetically determined or not, is that you like soft ice. Then also, if it's the setting is important, whether it's very, very cold, very, very dark. Imagine eating soft ice in complete darkness, in minus 30. Then you probably don't like soft ice because it's stiff and cannot be eaten. And it's very, very cold and completely dark. So this like or dislike, this whether the soft ice evoke positive emotions and pleasant mental or physical feeling on the tongue. This is not only determined by the biology and the circumstances, but also by the Kamma. In the case that is like this, if you have done a lot of bad, a lot of evil, then you will tend to dislike things, even though they are very pleasant. If one does a lot of good, then one like all things, also when they are unpleasant. One can cope with them, or one will see them as neutral. So let's say a karmically fortunate person that has done a lot of good, they meet some food that is not very well made, then they still like it. It still tastes good to them. While the same persons later, maybe 10 years later, have done something evil, then the same food, exactly the same food, tastes bad because of this karmic background. So the feeling is not determined exclusively by the object, whether it's soft ice or not, whether it's something that tastes good or not. It's also determined by the background, the karmic background, and also by the circumstances. So it's a complex situation where several factors, a multifactorial system where several factors determine the emotional content that is provoked by contact with the object. So the Buddha say, if there's contact, that is to say, the eye meets a form, for example, or the nose meets a smell and so forth, the tongue meets a taste, then consciousness arises, sense consciousness, either visual consciousness or smelling or tasting consciousness. This is contact. When there's contact, there will also be feeling. Here we have to say which feeling is then assigned. Yeah. Then the Buddha say if it's a feeling that has to be or will be, and that cope for a lot of factors, also the Kamma. Not only the characteristics of the object, but also the Kamma. Imagine, for example, if we take the circumstances first, that if you eat, first time you eat nougat, for example, then it tastes very nice. And the fifth time also you eat nougat, but if you eat nougat 10 times in a row, then it not taste nice. And if you eat it 100 times in a row, they force feed you nougat in a nougat prison, then you say, it's disgusting. So here the context, that is to say that you have already got 5 kilos of nougat, this French kind of chocolate. This determines that the object suddenly changes from being very attractive to being boring, to being disgusting, to being very, very repulsive. That you, no more nougat. In the karmic case, then the person, even though they were biologically fit to eat nougat and to like nougat, then they will say, I don't like nougat. This doesn't taste good to me. So if a person of bad moral character, or who has done a lot of evil towards their mother, father, or friends, or sangha, or animals, or whoever, they get something that is very delicious, then you will often see that they don't like it. They dislike it. Even though it is 98% of other people, they think it's very, very delicious and very, very luxurious, then these people that have done something bad, they dislike it. They dislike it. And they get an unpleasant feeling, karmically determined unpleasant feeling, even when they are faced with the pleasant object. So in this case, one can see that feeling and emotions, this also goes when you meet people and get emotions from situations. When you sit down and meditate, whether you feel peace or not, whether you feel pleasure or not, whether you feel joy or not, in the meditation situation, in the movie theater, wherever, in whatever situation it is, whether you like or dislike something is also karmically determined. It is not only karmically determined. Genes, DNA, chromosomes, inheritance from mother, father also has a small say. Circumstances also has a small say. Imagine if it's dark and minus 30 compared to now nice summer in the forest, then it's easy to feel pleasure and to have positive emotions. So we can at least point out three factors that determine the feeling. Not only the characteristics of the object that has to be there to be contacted, and then these feelings arise. From contact, passa, comes feeling, vedana, as the Buddha say. From feeling comes craving, tanha. So this is a crucial point, whether this feeling is arised or not. It determines the whole point, whether it's craving towards the object, away from the object, or is craving for ignoring the object and being contacted by another object. So this is a crucial thing. But this feeling then, the object of course has something to say, whether it's, for example, if it's soft ice, whether it's soft ice or rotten fish you have to eat, this will have a say. But even if you get the pleasant object, then also karma has a say. Evil karma will determine, will less the likelihood that one feels pleasure in all situations, whether soft ice or not. And good karma, good karmic accumulation will increase the likelihood that one assigns and feels pleasure by a given object and positive emotions in certain circumstances and social surroundings. So it is not only the object, nor the biology of the person, the inheritance, nor the circumstance that determines the characteristics of the object or the feeling. Is one, question C, two, is one reborn into a family or species that carries behavioral traits that fit with one karma? Yes, indeed one is, as we already determined before, it's a multifactorial system. And so one has basically a probability distribution. I'll show you one here on the screen. A probability distribution for experiencing certain situations. And one is reborn into the situation, both the genetic traits, whether one is an ant or whether it's a human being or as a deva, and circumstances in whether one is reborn in Denmark or in Sri Lanka or in Burma or in Australia or in USA. In a rich family or in a poor family, all these traits should fit the circumstances that are at this particular rebirth moment, where this already is, so to speak, laid out. It is already there as probabilities. So this set of probabilities tries to match the set of probabilities that are in the physical world. And there you can say there's no future and no present and no past, because the probabilities are already there, likelihoods are already there in the world, out there in the world. And the individual then comes with his particular set of probabilities, and they will fit the best match there is to all these karmic circumstances that this particular individual has its karmic past to come to experience. So one is reborn into this family or species and behavioral traits that fits with one's karmic pattern, one's karmic probability. That is to say, a bad karmic probability, if we just say very grossly, would mean lower rebirth. And in all of the circumstances, whether animal or human or deva, they will tend to look ugly, whether the good karmic probabilities will tend to look beautiful. And also they will feel more pleasure if they are kind-hearted, have been kind-hearted and have a good karmic accumulation. And their emotions will be more joy and gladness. So basically, the karmic imprint is everywhere present, is inherent in all circumstances that there is, where there basically can be a choice. There's a diversity between what you can experience. And this, I think that is in almost all situations. Imagine what you can feel when you eat a given kind of food. You can feel pleasure or boredom or neutral feeling and aversion in various degrees. And this also goes when you're faced with whatever circumstances out here in the forest or in any other social connection. You have a plethora of emotions and experiences to choose in between. And there the Kamma comes in and said, some are more likely than the other ones. And this that are more likely then will be experienced by the individual. See, the more interesting thing is Kamma creating the family, species and location one is reborn into? Yeah, one thing, the answer is actually yes, and has to do with the observer effect of quantum mechanics. The observer effect says that the observer has a crucial role in selecting out of what circumstance or what probability nature comes with. So nature comes with a probability, let's say the electron can be here, 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 and many times here, and not so much here. And then the observer comes and say, my probability distribution says I should see it here. And these two probability distributions are then summed up, so to speak. And then if you make enough experiments, then you will see that the summed up experiences of the summed up probabilities of the observer and nature, they will be fulfilled by multiple observations. So this means that the physical world depend upon the live beings, the conscious beings that inhabit this physical world. Because they are the electrons and thereby also the atoms and the molecules, they are in configurations that are even the weather patterns, whether there's oxygen or not, whether there's heat or not, suitable circumstances or not for life. This is dependent upon these beings that are going to be reborn in there. So this means that, for example, there will be no hills, no cavities inside the earth that are very hot iron places if there were no one to be reborn there. And same thing also with the heavens. They are created, they are coming out in periods after the Big Bang because there are beings that has to fall down to these levels or ascend to these levels and be conscious there. So the physical world is not independent of the summed up collective mental world that, so to speak, selects, it doesn't create de novo, but it selects which world, how the world will look like. The atoms out there, they are just forms of energy. They could be anything, so to speak. So nature comes with one probability distribution of what they can be. And then all the human beings, they come with another one. If for example, there's a lot of beings that are very good in an area and they have been it for a long time, then there will be sufficient rain and sun there for growing good food. If it's opposite, they have been very evil, then there will the likelihood of mudslide and storms and so forth, unfortunate circumstances and the weather, they will grow there. So the physical systems are not independent of the mental systems. Actually, it's continuum, and it can be seen from the perspective of information that both mental systems and physical systems are basically information, and which also is a form of energy. So a good action is one that creates harmony in an informational system, while a bad, evil action is one that creates disharmony or disequilibrium. Far from thermodynamical equilibrium is the situation that a bad action is. So it is connected through the system of information or the concept of information. So yes, Kamma do our behavior collectively. You can say even on the short-term range, let's take the teenager example, for example. The well-behaved teenager that have a good karmic accumulation, their room will be tidy. Why so nice? The parents treat them nice and give them nice clothing and bedding and pictures for the walls, but they also themselves choose some fortunate choices regarding their room. So their room will come to look nice. So it's their own behavior, that's a banal part of it, but it's also from the outside factors that the likelihood of somebody bringing into that room that is pleasant, like flowers, make the wall painting nice and so forth, put a carpet on the floor, this is higher when it is good beings that are living there. And oppositely, if it is a being that has unfortunate karma from their past bringing into this room. Similarly, with the much larger room that is the universe, or the physical world, is just many more inhabitants, not only the human beings, but also the divine beings, also the ants, the birds and so on. All are collectively co-creating this universe by selecting it in the case of observation. So they are selecting out which possibilities can come to be experienced, can come to be observed from a probability distribution nature comes with, a priori. And this means that the nature doesn't mind. It could be many worlds, both on the microscopic level and on the macroscopic level. But the beings that are inhabiting this world then select certain worlds, certain configurations of electrons, neutrons, protons, and thereby certain life forms, certain circumstances, certain weather patterns to occur or not occur. And that even without being conscious about it. So they affect the physical world by their behavior. Not only how they actually change. I could uproot this, I will never do that, but nevertheless, I could uproot this tree, of course, then I will affect the physical, I could also water it and give it fertilizer, then it will grow quicker, then I will affect the physical world. But this is not an observer effect, this is not a karmic effect, this is the direct effect on the physical world. The karmic effect is the likelihood of how the world develops by itself, so to speak, affected by these probabilities that are not directly visible, but nevertheless is a field all over the universe that determines in the laboratory what happens with at least microscopic systems so far we have observed. They don't behave in the exact same way when you repeat the experiments. They come out with some likelihoods, just like a dice. If we should take the dice, example of a dice, for example, then the dice will have an equal probability distribution of 6 outcomes, and they will all have 16%, namely 1/6, which is 16.66%. So all the outcomes of the dice will be equal. We call a flat probability distribution. Then you could do the interesting experiment. You could take a small nail and put inside the number 1 of the dice. Then the dice will fall more down. Number 1 will fall more down, this number 6 on the other side of the dice will come more up. This means that you get more sixes. So the number of sixes will go up and the number of runners will go down and the number of 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 will stay the same. In the unaffected case, you have not done anything to the dice, then if you throw it 6,000 times, you get approximately 1,000 runners, 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 and 6s. However, if you put a nail in the number 1, exactly in the number 1 eye that sits in the middle of the dice and then bangs it all the way in so it's flush with the surface, then when you throw the dice, the number 1 will go more down because the weight of the nail will point it more towards down. Then number 6 will come more upwards because the 6 is on the exact opposite side of number 1. And so you'll get more 6s. This is means to say, before we throw it, in the present, we can say something about the future. That is to say, if we see the probabilities of the 1s, this will go a little bit down. The 2, 3, 4, 5, it will be the same. And the number 6, the probability getting a number 6 will go up. Now we have an uneven probability distribution. You see? It's uneven. So probability of 1 is low. It's less than 16%. Let's say it's, for example, 5%. Then the probability of number 6, it has will go up the exact same that the number 1 goes down. This is to say, roughly 10% up, there will be 26%. And then to getting number 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, no, not 6, but 5, it will still be 16%. So you cannot see it in the single throw. That's why we become confused. We cannot see it in the single observation of our circumstances. There we cannot see our own imprint. But if you throw it 6,000 times, then suddenly you get only 500 oneers and 1,500 sixers and 1,000 twoers, threeers, four and fivers. and so forth. There you can see it. But if you have to do 6,000 actions before seeing it, then you forget the outcomes of the former actions. So you cannot remember it. And that's why we get confused. That's why we cannot see the karma. Because it's stochastic, which means it's not random, but it's influenced over many outcomes. And therefore we cannot see it. But nevertheless, it still holds if you count up all the outcomes of what you experience. For example, pleasure or pain. But then you have to eat the exact same food in the exact same circumstances. Let's say 600 times. Already that is impractical, huh? It's impossible. Not in principle, but in practical, in practice it is impossible. So we cannot see the karma there, and then we think it's not real. But it is real as anything else is. Then we come to question D. Question 386D. Are one's bodily feelings and mental emotions purely a physical phenomena of the body, or are they at least partly caused by one's karma? Yeah, we already talked about it before. Karma will determine influence with some certain probabilities or likelihoods or chance or risks, whether one will feel pleasure or pain or neutral feeling when faced or contacted by a given object, whether it be soft eyes, sex, money, or a fierce tiger. So this will determine the emotional response. So one thing is the body, how the body reacts, and for emotions, how the mind reacts on given circumstances. But this how one reacts is conditioned by one's karma. Again, let's say one eats soft ice and one has done a lot of evil, like killing one's mother and father and causing schism in the Sangha and so forth. Then one distastes the soft ice, the sugar, even though it's the same sugar, it's the same feeling of soft ice on the tongue for the evil person and for the good person. But the good person feels it as pleasure, while the bad person feels it as boredom or something dissatisfactory, actually as something that is basically suffering. This also goes with the feeling in the knee. So many of the emotions is determined by whether you have, even though you have a disease, some people have a disease, but they don't have pain. They don't feel pain. Or if they have pain, they have a little pain. And if they have a lot of pain, then they can stand the pain. And the evildoer, even though they have very, very little the sickness, maybe no sickness, then they still have pain in the knee and here and there and everywhere. And they also experience the circumstances as being unpleasant, even though they are very pleasant for other beings. So, yes, indeed, one's bodily feelings and mental emotions are karmically not determined, but influenced. It is still so if it's sunshine or soft ice, then all persons, also the evil one, will have a higher likelihood of feeling joy and pleasure. However, if you compare inside this group good persons with bad persons, then the bad persons will have lower likelihood of feeling joy and pleasure in sunshine and soft ice than the good persons. The good persons will, almost all of them, feel joy and pleasure, while only 50% of the bad persons will feel joy and pleasure. It's like that. Or you can say equally true, in 100% of the cases when faced with soft ice and sunshine, then the good persons will experience joy and pleasure. While only, let's say, in 30% of the cases, when the bad persons, the wrongdoer, is faced with soft ice and sunshine, then they will feel pleasure and joy. And this will go down, this likelihood will go down and down, the more heavy the bad karmic accumulation is. And vice versa, the good accumulation will increase the likelihood until it's certainty, so to speak, that the good person will feel pleasure and joy. So there's nothing strange in it. It is just this, that it affects us probabilistically, by probabilities, by chances, not deterministically. So it's very, very rare to have a situation where there's 0% chance or 100% chance for something given happening to a person. But it can be like that. Also, karmically determined. Both in the good case and in the bad case. As in the bad case of physical pain, I can mention a story from the Tipitaka. It's a monk, he travels around with the Buddha, and then he sits close to where the Buddha, he sits down. And then he experiences pains in his knee and his back. And then he says to himself, this pain I feel in my knee and in my back, this is karmically determined. It is not something I should mention to my friends. I just sit here and endure it. So, even though he's close to the Buddha, because of his karmic past, then he experienced pain in his knee and in his back. But he doesn't talk about it. He doesn't bother others about it. Because he realizes that this is his own karmic echo, his own karmic mirror reflection, basically, why it hurts. So it has not so much to do with the knee. It has to do with his past. So this is basically, we say physical disease and therefore pain and discomfort is caused by harming other beings in a non-lethal way. For example, hitting them with a hand or with a stick or with a knife, but they don't die, they just feel pain. Whether it can be animal, it can also be human beings, can be any being at all, that one is harming them physically. So they feel physical pain, bodily pain. This one is mirrored back as bodily pain. Same thing is one give pleasure to somebody, then pleasure also comes back. Question E. What is the creator, cause and force behind the concept of karmic justice? I don't like this justice, because actually there's no judge involved. But we can just say karmic justice, everybody knows what it is. That doing good brings good and doing bad brings bad. In other words, why is it so? Yeah, basically it's just a karmic effect that is affecting these probabilities. So it is determined, first of all, not by the actual action, whether it's a mental action, verbal action, or physical action. It's determined by the intention behind the action. And this intention behind the action spreads out as probability waves from the individual actually at the moment the person makes the intention. So in a split second, it is everywhere present. And this means that there will be an echo to meet out. Just like if you yell out something, there the echo will also spread, but it's fairly slow. If you turn on a torch and put it into a mirror, then it will come back with the speed of light, basically. So that's very quickly. But this effect is probably quicker than that. It's an information that is spreading at least with the speed of light, but if we call it to recall the non-locality of quantum mechanics, there's non-local effects that is everywhere present spontaneously and instantaneously. Then the karmic effect also will go faster than the light, or actually be present at other locations also faster than the light can travel to this other location. So wherever you go, it is there. So how can it be explained? Yeah, it's a nature law, and they can often be difficult to explain. For example, it's the example of gravity. Everybody knows gravity is here. It's also non-local. It's also there. It is also in Copenhagen. It's also in Paris. It's also on Sri Lanka. Same thing will happen. Huh? This will fall. It will be falling in a direction towards the center of planet Earth, because this is the center of gravity. And so also beings, if they do bad, then they will also fall in the existential state. One way of seeing it, I think the best way of seeing it is this echo. Basically, that is just an echo that comes back, and it comes back delayed. Imagine you yell out in an echo valley, then the echo comes one time. Hello, then you just come, hello, hello, hello. It will come back from this echo valley, depending on the geometry of the echo valley. But it will come back more than one time. So also in an action that is basically a wave of probability, not a wave of sound pressure that is sent out, but it's a wave of probability. This also will be echoed back by the universe and other beings that are the echo wall, and come back to the doer, wherever this doer are, wherever this actor that has formed this intention are present, then they will meet this reflection of probabilities. And this can take a long time, This can take several universes before it comes back. Why is it so that good brings good and bad brings bad? Yeah, basically it's a little bit like thermodynamics. If one recall the second law of thermodynamics, it says that entropy, which is a form of disorder, it always increases. So disorder always increases. It's also, if you lose a glass and it bangs on the floor, then it goes into disorder. It's never so that or if you smash an egg and it splashes out on the floor, well, then it never goes back into the ordered state spontaneously. You have to collect it, put it into energy into the system, then you can collect it. But otherwise, it will keep it on being disordered. Same thing with the body. If it's not pumped up with energy, then it will go back to a disordered state of earth and water and whatever it is. The basic constituents of, there's some calcium and some iron, but not very much. Most of it is water. This will evaporate, and then there will be rotten flesh left, and there will be ash, and then it will go back to dirt, a form of dirt. Huh? The bones will last a little longer, but nevertheless, eventually they will also degrade. So physical systems, if they left alone, not pumped up by energy, then their disorder will increase. Another way of seeing this is that, for example, if you have a ice cube and you put an ice cube into a glass of water, like you see here, then then the water molecules is with a certain distance, is collected in a crystal, a water crystal. And there they are vibrating very little, so their mean distance is very much the same. And it's very small. However, if you plump it into the water, then eventually it will melt. And there you can say, from before it melts, then we have a situation where in the ice crystals, or same thing in the salt crystal, there will be a lot of order, because all the molecules, they sit in a framework, in a matrix, and so they are completely locked into a gitter, where all the distances between them are the same. So it's a very ordered state. While the molecules out in the water, they are floating around between each other, almost freely, not completely freely, but almost freely, and so they are in a more disordered state. So there you have some, in the glass of water, you have a situation where there's disorder around, as in a small corner of order. So this is a very disharmonious state. It is not an equilibrium. It's not an even balance. Because from the point of view of distance and speed of water molecules, then there's very large difference between the crystal and the fluid water. However, if you let the system stand just for some while, some hours, then the ice will melt, or the salt crystal will be dissolved. And so this means that the molecules inside the crystal, which is either before was locked, they will go into solution, and then they will also start to move around and bump into each other and act disordered. And so after a while, the ice will have melted and the salt crystal will have dissolved completely, and there's an even distribution of salt all over the glass. And there's an even distribution of distance between the molecules all over the glass. This also regarding temperature. The temperature between the water, which was a very different thing in the ice and in the fluid water, is now evened out. And the salt concentration, which was very high in salt crystal before, it dissolves, and very low in the pure water. This also is evened out, because the salt then diffuses out and distributes in the entire glass of water after a while. So after this while this has happened, then we call it this equilibrium, it's balance. There's no differences down in the system. Same thing also you can say with an informational system. If you put bits of information down in a system, then they can fit each other or they cannot fit each other. There can be large differences between them. For example, if there has been a lot of statements said in a social system, one should not kill, one should not kill, one should not lie, one should not steal. But still, in this social system, there's a lot of stealing, a lot of lying, a lot of killing. Then there will be unrest in this social system. There will be disharmony, both from an informational point of view, But also if you look at the social circumstances in this particular society, then there will be a lot of unrest. There will be a lot of revenge. There will be a lot of putting people into jails. There will be a lot of jails. There will be a lot of agony, and both from being provoked outside by these actions and also from internal, from having performed these actions. There will be a lot of restlessness and regret, so to speak. However, in the same informational systems, if there's only two statements down in this closed box of information, that is to say, there is an information string, one should not kill, and no killing has happened in this box of information. So there's no event that it says, here's a killing. There's no information denoting or symbolizing or expressing a kill down in the information box. And so also with all the other statements, one should not lie, one should not steal, one should not sexually abuse. It doesn't happen down in this social box. If this is the case on the social level, then there's an equilibrium between the statements, the information of the statements, and also the information of the actions these particular beings do. And there will be equilibrium on the information level and also equilibrium on the social level. And there will be less use of a prison, less revenge, less disharmony, less conflict, and more happiness and more harmony and feeling at rest and ease and peace because of this consistency between the information and the actions down in this system, in the good system. So, seen from a physics point of view, moral actions can be likened to those who lead to thermodynamic equilibrium, which means in a physical system that everything is evenly distributed and have the same temperature and same level of disorder. While in the social system, it means that it's close to harmony, it's close to peace, it's close to absence of conflict of any kind. So these two systems, though they look to be very different, they are, from an informational point of view, very like each other. It's the same thing happening in these two systems, the social systems and the physical systems. You can have disequilibrium, far from equilibrium situations in the physical systems, and they will correspond to from harmony, far from peace in the social systems, and also in the individual mental system of each single individual, which also is a system of information. So there's no wonder, you can say, it's just action and reaction. It is to say, make an echo of a very high voice, like this, then there will also come an echo back within a very high voice, pitch voice. But if you make a bass echo, a bass voice, hello, out there in the valley, then there will also come a bass echo back. Same thing if you put a red light into a mirror, then there come red light back. If you put white light into a mirror, then there come white light back. So it is just a matter of reflection. It's a reflection of probabilities that has this particular nature. If this reflection, if this action of probability, the action that has been performed, outward going probabilities, is something that causes disharmony in the system, then the corresponding probabilities that is echoed, mirrored back, they are also something that cause disharmony, that is to say pain in the individual and conflict in the social system. On the other hand, if the outgoing probability from the good action, the kusala, advantageous action, is something that is good, that is harmonious, that makes harmony out there, that makes peace out there, that makes pleasure and joy out there, that makes rest and ease out there, then it's the same thing that is mirrored back. So it is just outly equals in, basically. It is what you send out comes back. It has nothing to do with any judge. There's no judgment. It's just cause and effect. And it's cause and effect because, I think, at least, you cannot say, the Buddha didn't say anything specifically about it, because it's a nature law. You cannot say, why is there gravity? This we cannot even explain today. Quantum gravity is not yet explained. So why there is gravity, we don't know, but we know that there's a gravity. We can measure it and calculate it and so on. But why is there? It's very difficult to say. It's because there is a Higgs boson. Yes, but why is the Higgs boson there? This is only one way of interpreting it. But looking at the Kammic law from a physical perspective makes sense if you look at it from information that creates harmony or disharmony. It's the same as physical action that creates order or disorder. A physical action that creates order in a glass of water will be that you take heat out of it, then you take disorder out of it, then you freeze it down, then you create order on it. Same thing with heating it up, then there will be disorder. So these physical actions can correspond or be likened to mental actions. The mental actions also, because they are information and thereby they are a form of energy, also is a form of sending something out, an action that makes a reaction come back as an echo or as a reflection or as a mirrored response. So there's nothing metaphysical or mystical about it, nor is there any judge sitting up there or anywhere else noting your actions. Your actions is accumulated in this quantum mechanical wave function, universal quantum mechanical wave function, so they can be sampled by other beings at a later time point, including yourself. But they are not. It's something that happens automatically by each observation, each conscious observer does, each event happening. It's not something that is that there's anybody judge that notes or determines other beings' future. That is impossible. It's only our own accumulation of good, bad, and neutral actions that determines our future. So is it. It is not otherwise. So, seen from this point of perspective, karma is not something metaphysical or something that is something to be going to believe, because quantum mechanics basically is a system of probabilities that already have been found for very simple physical systems that doesn't behave, that behaves stochastically, we say. It doesn't behave the same way for each outcome of the experiment. And so also we don't experience the same thing even though we have made the same actions. Another interesting consequence of that, let's say there's a person with a good accumulation and then there's a person with a bad accumulation. If they do the exact same thing, the exact same action, whether good or bad or neutral, they do not experience the same echo. Why not? Because though the echo from the external world is the same, it comes into their context of karmic accumulation. So the good action will be enhanced by the good person's other karmic accumulation. While if there's a good action from the bad person, then it will just be subtracted his other bad actions. So he might not feel it as pressure, though the good person feels it as pressure. The bad person doesn't feel it as pressure, he feels it as a neutral feeling. And then he has counteracted some of his bad karma. So probabilities and karma are additive. That is, you could say you can add them up, stack them up, and subtract them from each other. So this means that if you do something good, then your accumulation of bad goes down. If you do something bad, then your accumulation of good goes down. So it's a balance all the time. And so it comes into a context of not only what you did yesterday, but also what you did last life, and 10 lives ago, and 10 universes ago. And all these actions are then summed up at a given time point, as you see in the illustration here. At a given time point, there will be good actions on the above zero and bad actions below zero. And then it will come out. The summation of this will come out whether you feel pain, red color, or you feel pleasure, green color. So this means that that many actions, thousands of actions, both mental actions, verbal actions, and bodily actions from a distant past and also a recent past, they are summed up in each moment and then will determine whether one feels pleasure or pain in that particular moment, and what one experiences, so to speak. And so it goes on. It's a probabilistic law. Just like if we look at the electron that can be at various places, then it has a probabilistic distribution that goes like this. Then only 1 out of 100 times we find it here and here, but 1 out of 5 times we find it here in the middle where the probability is high. But this doesn't give us any access to say what will happen next time we shoot an electron along this road here, where it will stop, here or here or here or here. We can only say it has a probability distribution that is like this. When we make 1,000 experiments, then we find it 100 times here, 98 times here, 78 times there, 5 times here, 1 time there, 3 times there, and so on. So we can say it's the probability distribution fits the experiment. And that's why we can, I think one can claim today that the Kammic law is proven in experiments, because quantum mechanics is proven in experiment. Actually, it's never has never made a wrong prediction. And the ultimate reality in quantum mechanics is probabilities. Probabilities for certain outcomes in the future, in a future observation for a given observer. And so also with Kamma, it is probabilities for certain events, certain experiences, pleasure, pain, forest or desert, in the future for a given observer. Neither more nor less. And so is it. I think it is good news in the sense that we can affect our own probabilities. We can determine our own future without knowing it, but consciously. Whether we know it or not, it doesn't matter. Nature just has to send the same reflections back. If you turn on a red light into a mirror, it cannot choose to send white light back, huh? Nor can it choose to send no light back. It has to reflect the light and send it back. And so it is impossible not to get a karmic reflection. Impossible. It has to be. It has to come. I think it's something, if you know how to drive, so to speak, then it leaves the possibility, the option of doing something good here in this world. Like listening to Dhamma videos and trying to shape one's behavior after it, and making Dhamma videos also. Producing them and putting them on YouTube, and even making YouTube available for all beings for free. Very good action, resulting in a very good business on the social level, huh? So it's good news. If it was completely random what you experienced, then you would have no chance of shaping your own future. Neither would the other extreme, if it was completely determined, locked by one's past, then you have no personal freedom to change it. Then you could not go scot-free, you could not change your behavior. It will all be karmically determined. But this is not the case. This is probabilistically determined. There is a 90% chance conditioning for this and that will happen, or 50% chance, or 22% chance. If there's a 22% karmic conditioning, and the circumstances come with 22%, this adds up 44%. This means still that you have the remaining 66%. No, 56%. 56 plus 44 means 100%. So you have 56% free choice of either choosing the good or the bad or the neutral. And so also it goes, if there's 90% conditioning from the physical world and from the karmic background, then there's still 10% personal freedom to make the right choice or the wrong choice or the neutral choice. It will, in the 90% case, it will be experienced that it's much more difficult to make the right choice. You're like pushed in the back and also pushed by circumstances. I would say, maybe I should do like, not like this, not like that. I should do it in another way. So there still is personal freedom. That something is completely determined, like a destiny is, for example, is very, very rare to see. But it does happen. For example, we know the next Buddha you see here, his name will be Ajitamiteya, the unconquerable friend. This is determined now. But I said it before, what he has to dinner on his 7 years birthday, this is probably not determined yet. He can have various, probably very pleasant choices between soft ice, ananas, and fruit salad, for example. So there will be various choices, what all of them will be good for him. But we cannot say exactly which one, it's not determined yet which one he will have. Let's say if there's these three choices of soft ice, ananasi, pineapple, or fruit salad, then there will be, it's equal probabilities, then it will be 33%, three outcomes that it means 33% each. Huh? But we don't know which one he will pick, so to speak. So now there is a probability distribution of equal outcomes between these, only these three outcomes. If we take with honey, honey cake as a fourth outcome, then the probability will, an even probability distribution will be 25%. But what I'm saying is that they are almost never even. They are always uneven, different probabilities. It's only in the constructed case of a dice that you have exactly the same probabilities for each outcome, namely 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So this is very, 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 very rare. So it's just this, that we doubt in the Kammic law, this is because that these different outcomes that are present in most situations for human beings, is that they come in jumbled up order. And we have to observe hundreds of them, or thousands of them, to understand that, and thereby note in our small note block, write down in our computer which outcome there was from this given particular event, this experiment we made with ourselves, in order to see whether we experience pleasure or pain, whether we have success or not, whether we are fortunate or unfortunate in the given situation. And then we should repeat the exact same situation, let's say 1,000 times. This is unpractical. Huh? And even if you do it, then it's still, you will only get a probability distribution. You will see that this is karmically shaped. You will see that distributions are different from evil doers from good doers. And that is actually what the Buddha sees when he has a divine eye, where he sees beings disappear here by death and then he reappear there. Then he says, those who did evil deeds, those who are wrongdoers, rapists, those who disregard the noble ones, those who disrespect the Dhamma, those who don't give, those who steal, they will be reborn in a low place, in a unsuccessful place, in the downfall. They will have fallen in the existential level from human to animal, for example. Or if in the animal realm, they will have fallen from a high animal, like a lion, to a lower animal, like an insect. Or within the human realm, they will have fallen from a rich, beautiful person to a poor, a ugly person, for example. While he say, if when I see with this my divine eye, a being dying here and reappearing there, then I can see if they can also see their past, they can see all their actions in one go, then those beings with a good karmic accumulation, the good doers who respect the noble ones, who don't disparage the noble ones, who respect the Dhamma, who act accordingly by giving, by helping, and by staying with the truth and not stealing, they become reborn in fortunate circumstances, even in the divine heavens. So he sees there by direct experience a causal relation between the accumulation of behavior in the being that is dying and in the being that is re-arising, the circumstances they re-arise in, and the abilities of the circumstances say they re-arise in, what they can do and what they cannot do. So there they have direct experience, they see the karmic law, but this takes the divine eye, the deeper chakra, to get. So many were the words for today. Again, Kamma is a law on par with gravity. It's a stochastic or probabilistic law that determines the probabilities for future outcomes. It is connected with quantum mechanics and determines which, if you see the systems as made of information, that it can either be consistent or in harmony or in disharmony then there's no problems understanding what karma and the law of karma is. Then it's self-evident that it has to be like that. It has to be like that. There has to be a reflection. There has to be a mirror echo, or an echo back. And in this case, in an echo of probability. So when you're hit by a wave of probability, and not a sound wave or a light wave, but a wave of probability, then this probability will make you feel certain feelings and make you experience certain experiences. And so you absorb this probability and thereby use it up. Then that is used up. Then there come another wave, another wave. These waves one oneself has set going in the past and the distant past and the very distant past. And they are non-local. This means that they are everywhere present. So wherever you go, you'll meet your karmic echo. There's no choice. And also, nature has no choice, but we have a choice. We have a choice to do good or bad or neutral. We have a choice to act according to the Dhamma or not. We have a choice to do meditation and purify our morality to come to meditate better and thereby have better insight into the nature of things. And this choice we should utilize. Physical systems don't have this choice. This plant don't have this choice. And if you go down to animal realm, then they have a lower degree of choice than we have. So we should utilize this opportunity where we have a choice to do good. Thank you. Thank you for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Contributions are still very welcome because we are working at making a forest monastery here in Denmark, and still contributions are needed, either whether we should rent a place or buy a place. Then I'm very much interested in contact people, because it will be good for the Danish people to have an opportunity to meditate on a longer scale in a given place where they also can live. And the weather was some forest, so it's more harmonious. So contributions for this purpose is very welcome, because the price level here in Denmark is fairly expensive. And it's also good karma. And I would like to say thank you for those who are already contributing, especially the long-term the long-term Dayakas, or donors, or Dayakas, we call them. Dayakas supporters, Buddhist supporters, I like to express my sincere gratitude to, that has supported me over the years, so to make this Dhamma freely available for all. May it continue even so for a long, long, long time. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. And may you indeed have a nice and noble day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Bambarella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct, and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya, will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.